Tonight, several tech bigwigs launch new startups. We'll talk about some of those, including the new Talko app, which is not food related. And can you really hack Touch ID with glue? Tech News Tonight is next.
This is Twit.
This is Tech News Tonight, episode 178 for Tuesday, September 23rd, 2014. This episode is brought to you by Citrix ShareFile. Enhance your workflow, send files of almost any size easily and securely with ShareFile. For a free 30-day trial, go to ShareFile.com, click the microphone, and enter TN2. Hi, everybody. I'm Sarah Lane, and let's get right into today's tech feed. The Information is reporting that Apple's former senior vice president of retail, Chief Ron Johnson, is launching a gadget delivery service, citing people who spoke with Johnson on the project. The service is said to be an on-demand delivery service for electronic devices, which would be taking on some new offerings from Amazon and Google and even Uber, which has begun experimenting with food order deliveries. Johnson has apparently hired on former Apple employees to help with the new venture, including Vice President of Retail Jerry McDougall, who left Apple back in 2013. Johnson is best known for creating the Apple Store concept, at least the one that we know of these days. He left the company in 2011 to take on a position at JCPenney, but was fired in April of last year. Home automation is becoming a crowded market, although sort of slow to adopt, with Google buying smart thermostat maker Nest, Microsoft partnering with Smart Labs, Insteon, Apple's HomeKit, which was announced at WWDC back in June, Samsung's purchase of SmartThings last month. But New York-based startup called Wink, which launched in June with a $79 box, promises to tie together devices across competing standards. Might have a leg up on some of these other companies. Standards like Wi-Fi, Bluetooth, Zigbee, Z-Wave. Now, big companies like Honeywell, Philips, Chamberlain, Schlage, GE and other large brands are already creating Wink-compatible products, so that's promising. Big merchants like Home Depot and Amazon are already marketing the Wink brand. And today the company has announced its second big product called Relay. It's a $300 wall mount touchscreen that acts as a command and control center for connected devices in your house. The Relay would connect to standard wiring on any light switch, has a touchscreen to program devices to work in sync, and two physical buttons that execute programs, shutting the house down for the night, for example, or powering up everything in the morning. Very interesting. Google search results are getting more and more factual. Earlier this month, Search Engine Land noticed that Google was testing a form of knowledge graph data within a snippet of search results, and the feature has now been confirmed by Google on its research blog. Google calls these structured snippets, where Google will show snippets of data that are relevant to whatever the search query was within the snippet itself of the results. The company says that the data is powered by the knowledge graph and other data sources. So, for example, a search for a Nikon D7100 camera now includes sensor resolution and weight and display size in those snippet results. PayPal is warming up to Bitcoin, slowly but surely. The company has announced partnerships with three leading Bitcoin payment processors in the U.S. and Canada, BitPay, Coinbase, and GoCoin. PayPal, which is owned by eBay, wants to help merchants accept Bitcoin payments, and a PayPal spokesperson tells The Next Web, "We are considering expanding to other markets." PayPal says it chose to integrate with the third-party functionality directly in the PayPal Payments Hub with all three Bitcoin payment processors because they already offer customers protections when dealing with this virtual currency. PayPal is not adding Bitcoin as a currency to its own digital wallet, though, nor is it processing Bitcoin payments on its own payments platform. Everything is being handled by the third-party services. Even if it's baby steps, though, even then, the price of Bitcoin jumped up around $50 today following the PayPal news after hovering between about $400 and $500 since April. Coming up, can you really hack Apple's Touch ID on the iPhone 6 with super glue? And up next, I'll chat with Roberto Baldwin from The Next Web about a new app from former Microsoft chief software architect Ray Ozzie. What is he doing? But first, let's talk about being organized at work. We're sending emails all day long to communicate with our clients and our coworkers. Sometimes it's about birthday cake. Sometimes it's about something really important. Most of the time, yeah, we're attaching files and there's reference and there's spreadsheets and, oh, you got to sign this contract and there's a presentation coming up, photos, the list goes on. But if you send them as regular email attachments, you've got bounce back sometimes. The file size is too large, depending on who you're working with. People have, you know, the inboxes that are so clogged, they're not going to see your notes. Citrix Share File is exactly the solution because it eliminates the hassles of regular old email attachments, which just simply don't work that well anymore. We here at Twit use Share File, and you should think about using it too because it's the business solution that allows you to exchange files really quickly and, more importantly, securely. With Citrix Share File, your attachments are sent as secure links. You can send files of pretty much any size. You can control who has access to those files. You can set permission levels depending on if you want somebody in there just to take a look at it or actually do some editing. You can confirm when files are received so you know who has seen it and when. Plus, Share File is easy to use. You can access your files anywhere. A lot of us are remote half the time. So you can create shared folders that sync automatically across however many computers you're using, your mobile devices as well. We use Share File all the time, like millions of other professionals, and you should too. You should sign up today for a 30-day free trial. No obligation. You get those 30 days completely free. Just go to sharefile.com, and you want to click on the microphone at the top of the homepage and enter TN2. That's TN and the number 2. Visit sharefile.com, type in TN2, and get those 30 days free. And enjoy collaboration. It's next level stuff. All right, joining us now is Roberto Baldwin, reporter over at The Next Web. Welcome back to the show, Roberto.
Thanks for having me on.
Well, thanks for being here. So let's talk about Ray Ozzie, who is, you know, he was a big wig. He was the chief software architect at Microsoft. He also invented Lotus Notes. God, I hated Lotus Notes, but I used it for many, many years in various corporate establishments. Made a lot of money. And now it was like midnight last night when the embargo lifted and there was all this news about Ray Ozzie's reinventing the phone call. So what is this venture?
Well, it's Talko. It's hard to say without saying Talko.
It sounds like food, but it's T-A-L-K-O.
And it has nothing to do, like you said, with delicious tacos. So it is. They're marketing it as a conference call app. So you can, you know, everyone gets into your Talko group and you can talk to each other. You press down and you talk, and then other people talk. So you're not talking over each other. Everyone's sort of taking turns talking. And it gives you the ability, you know, it saves that conversation so you have it for later. You're able to bookmark certain elements of the conversation. You can share photos. You can share photos. You can share audio. You can just type and chat, you know, if you're in a loud room. It's intriguing. I don't know if it's going, if voice is the new killer app. But, you know, but it's also entering a very, very crowded messenger world right now.
Yeah, not only a crowded messenger world, but as you mentioned, the idea of audio being bundled into a lot of these apps, it's kind of becoming mainstream. Even iOS 8 itself now has an audio feature, and I'm trying to like it, but I don't really know why I want to go back to listening to people's voices because the whole beauty of text is avoiding those people. But if you have a conference call, and that's just me. If you have conference, right? Yeah, this is why we work in the business that we do. Conferences, though, and especially something that's, you know, you think about it as far as business or enterprise, that's a little bit different because those are sort of a necessary evil for people all the time. Do you see something like this as the next phase of collaboration? I'm not sure why it's, besides being marketed towards people at work, how it's so different than what other messaging apps already offer.
Yeah, and it's coming out in the world with Slack and with Convo and with HipChat and, you know, all these other, and people, you know, especially Slack, you can do so much with that app. It launches initially on the iPhone. They will have a web app and they will have an Android app, which is good. The web app, I think, is going to be what gets, you know, businesses to work, because when you don't want to have a conference call where everyone's like tapping, you know, doing this a lot with their phones. I don't know. I'm unsure of how well it's going to be, used by the business world, because conference, and most businesses, if they have a conference call, they already have that giant, that big triangle circle in the middle of the room where you hit the thing, you hit it, everyone talks, and everyone still talks over each other. And so I don't know if everyone's just going to, okay, let's stop using the thing that we've been using for 10, 15 years and start using this app. Everyone needs to download this app.
And I read an interview that Stephen Levy over from Medium had conducted with Ray Ozzie, and there were a lot of interesting things, even though obviously Ray comes from a corporate background. He did say, this is not the sort of app that's just supposed to be used for business. If everyone can't use it, it doesn't scale, and it just, it fails. That's sort of the world that we live in when we think about apps now. Do you see this as something that you and I could use on a friend basis? I mean, it's something that doesn't seem work-related, because it does seem like a really great tool, but how do you market that to just consumers?
You know, it's tough. I mean, we have Voxer and a bunch of other apps that allow you to send your voice, and, they had, initially everyone was using it, and then it just kind of died off, and everyone goes back to texting. So, there's so many messaging apps. There's WhatsApp, there's Line. There's just SMS that people are already using. It's going to be tough to get, the average person to use this app. And it's actually a little, there's so many features, which is great for business. And, but there's so many features. It's actually a little confusing. And my version, it kept crashing and it was acting a little weird, which is, death for an app. If you open an app and it's, and your first reaction or your first use is it's crashing, it's acting odd. You don't quite understand what you're doing, especially for messaging. You want something that's just easy, kind of a one-trick pony. And it's a very robust app. And so because it's so robust, I don't know if the average person is going to sort of, adopt it.
I guess before I let you go, one of my bigger, let's look at this whole idea of messaging and how the future looks for us. Question for you, Roberto, is... Do we need this when we are, the phone call is sort of, well, that's the old way of doing things. Nobody really wants to talk on the phone anymore. So we've got all these messaging apps and some of those seem cumbersome. Is it inevitable that some of that voice and talking kind of comes back into messaging? Because video isn't always appropriate, but voice is pretty easy to integrate. But do we want that? Are we regressing back into a world of voice communication?
It's tough to beat just a phone call. I get on conference calls all the time as part of my job. And if I have to, it's easy just to get on that call and make that call. And if you're trying to beat something that's very easy to do, you need to make it as easy. And this, I don't think Talko is really doing that right now.
All right, Ray Ozzie, you heard it here. Roberto Baldwin is a reporter over at The Next Web and an often appearer on TN2 here. Appearer. Thank you so much for being back with us, Roberto, and let folks know where they can read some of your recent work.
You can read it on The Next Web.
All right.
.com.
All right. See you soon. See you on Twitter. Have a taco.
I will.
Okay, good. All right, moving on. With Apple selling a record number of iPhone 6 and 6 Plus handsets in their initial weekend, 10 million, I believe, more folks than ever have access to Touch ID to unlock not just the 5S, it was new with the 5S model, but now the iPhone 6 and the iPhone 6 Plus with a scanned fingerprint. Well, after hacking Touch ID last year, security firm Lookout has tested the security of Touch ID and unlocked an iPhone 6... using a fake fingerprint made of glue. However, don't panic yet. It's pretty unlikely that most consumers need to worry about this. As Reed Wright points out, not only does a hacker need a clear print from whatever the target person is that can be lifted using super glue fumes and fingerprint powder, but then they need access to lab equipment to photograph and print and then cast the fingerprint using chemicals and then smearing it with glue. Accessing a device the way that Lookout did does work, but it obviously takes some significant skill and effort and time. Through the experiment, though, Lookout researcher Mark Rogers discovered there's no real improvement in the fingerprint sensors between the iPhone 5S and the iPhone 6, except he got fewer false negatives on the 6, meaning at least the readings are getting clearer. And that is it for this edition of Tech News Tonight. Thanks for being here. You can subscribe to the show at twit.tv/TN2. You can write us with feedback at tn2@twit.tv. And don't miss Tech News Today. That will be tomorrow, 10 a.m. Pacific, 1 p.m. Eastern, and then the day after that, and then the day after that. And it's just, you know, a cool weekday thing that you can do in the morning and the evening. Okay, I'm going to stop talking now. I'm Sarah Lane. Thanks for watching.
Bandwidth for Tech News Tonight is brought to you by CashFly.com.